Алло, Дона Дока, да ты видишь? Что-то у меня не видно. А, все, гада, все, гада, видно. Я магандя, пламенищего, крытка магандя, мштик, что-то у меня дядя мняться, ел глючешти. Все? Вон, хорошо, давай, сукчес. Да, косу, да, сегур. Вон, я вон чепен регистрали. Хорошо.
Da, doamna profesor, a acceptat aici, dar prezentarea încă nu. Prezentarea încă nu se vede, ți-a părut, dar...
Se vede, prezentarea se vede.
Nu, eu vorbesc cu doamna profesor Țurcan, care are problemă cu deconectare și imediat, a mie, da, imediat. Светлана Ивановна читеште ла румын, шо ти конектат, но шинари Wi-Fi, и цифару презентаре, шо де че, ја куту мне и ворбем.
Ам înțeles.
Ма аузис, дана професор? Светлана Ивановна, ма аузис? Да, ма аузис. 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 Domnul doctor, fără vreo părerea să vedeți, o să ajutați, că eu mă duc și încep la mine. Deci, eu sunt aici, ești calculator, dar sunt cu punct că știu că sunt sau de la mine și dacă mă spuneți înregistrarea când o să înceapă lecția. Bine? Bun, mulțumesc. Eu nu știu, ești 59, dar eu accept, că eu mi-am pus în față. Eu am să-i dă șansă, accept. Sunt cu două calculatoare.
Așa, gata, ai. Good afternoon, students. Do you hear me? I think yes. We will continue today with treatment of liver cirrhosis. Mă auziți, da? Write, please, in the chat if you hear me and if you can see the presentation.
Yes, it's okay. We see you and hear okay. Your presentation.
Okay,
guys, please write your feedback if you are here and see and hear all of this. Thank you. Okay, yes. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes, students are here. We start today with treatment of liver cirrhosis, and we'll discuss about the goals of treatment and the major goals of treatment in patients with liver cirrhosis include slowing or reversing the progression of liver disease, preventing superimposed insult to the liver, preventing and treating the complication. This is another part. We'll discuss about the treatment of all the syndromes of complication of liver cirrhosis. And another is to determine the optimal time for liver transplantation in patients with liver cirrhosis. And management should aim to prevent progression, not to treat the complication, okay, is the main aim of treatment. And two alternative approaches can be taken. This is suppress the etiological factors that cause liver inflammation and cirrhosis development, and target key factors in pathogenesis of cirrhosis, decompensation, and progression. How we prevent the superimposed insult, and what does it mean? Patients with cirrhosis should avoid any agent that has the potential to cause additional liver injury. And this includes abused substances such as alcohol consumption, over-the-counter medications such as higher doses of acetaminophen or another drugs with hepatotoxic effect, herbal remedies, and what also is important, vaccination against the hepatitis A and B can help prevent the superimposed insult to the liver that may have little functional reserve. But I want to pay your attention that vaccination in case if the etiology of liver disease is not hepatitis B, yes, only in patients with liver cirrhosis for another etiology. Against the hepatitis A, yeah, all the patients can be vaccinated because this kind of hepatitis or virus not lead to chronic disease. And several studies have been evaluated to prevent disease progression in patients with decompensated cirrhosis. and this targeting microbiome abnormalities and bacterial translocation. Do you remember was Friday? We'll discuss about hepatic encephalopathy and about the spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. And I said one of the cause of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis is hyperpermeability of the intestinal gut. It's bacterial translocation. And in this treatment, we will discuss about non-absorbable antibiotics like rifaximin. Improving the disturbed circulatory function. For this, we use long-term albumin administration. Treating the inflammatory states, and now is discussing about statins in this, and of course, targeting the portal hypertension and prevention of bleeding from varices with non-selective beta blockers. The potential effectiveness of improving circulatory and kidney function by long-term administration of albumin to patients with decompensated cirrhosis. Another potential therapeutic strategy in prevention of decompensation may be anticoagulation. And where demonstrated that 12-month course of enoxaparin was safe and effective in preventing portal vein thrombosis in patients with cirrhosis with child score more than 7 points, 7, 10 points. What else? About pentoxifilin treatment, significantly reduce the risk of liver-related complication compared to placebo in advanced cirrhosis. And also was demonstrated that pentoxifilin has the anti-tumor necrosis factors effect with anti-fibrotic effect in patients with liver cirrhosis. We will discuss at the end of our lecture about anti-fibrotic treatment that can stop progression of fibrosis. And also pentoxifilin prevents intestinal bacterial translocation and development of systemic inflammation. And of course, about propranolol, beta blockers, we will discuss. Okay, I think we will start with etiological treatment because, as I said, and we'll discuss on Friday also, patient, we need remove the etiological factors that can decrease or stop progression of inflammation and fibrosis. And we start with treatment very quickly because you discussed a lot about etiological treatment in chronic hepatitis. We'll be lecture about cholestatic disease, but quickly to pass about etiological treatment and start with treatment of patient with cirrhosis caused by HBV infection, by virus B. And what is the important in treatment of cirrhosis? As a priority, all adults or all patients with chronic hepatitis B and clinical evidence of compensated or decompensated cirrhosis, now we discuss about cirrhosis, based of APRI score more than 2 or based of FibroScan, regardless of LP levels, HBL antigen and HBV DNA levels, need treatment. Okay, how you understood this statement? Students, if you remember about treatment in chronic hepatitis, we have some indication for treatment. Students, what are the indications for treatment in case of chronic hepatitis B? What we take in consideration? Activity, yes. We should see them the level of LTSD. Of course, which we take in consideration level of the HBV DNA. And in case of liver cirrhosis, regardless of ELT levels, of DNA level, patient needs antiviral treatment. Do you understand what I mean? Yes? Patient with decompensated cirrhosis and detectable HBV DNA require urgent antiviral treatment with nucleotide analogs. And the first line drugs are entecavir and tenofovir, a potent HBV inhibitors with high barrier of resistance. Lamivudine should not be used in such patient. And what else is important? That nucleotide analogs therapy should usually be continued and definitely in cirrhotic patients for long time, like studied in case of hepatitis. About pegylated interferon, in case of hepatitis, you discussed about two lines of treatment, yes? Analogs, nucleotide analogs, and interferon. Remember, please, that interferon is contraindicated in decompensated cirrhosis. Can be used, can be indicated only in cirrhosis child A, but not more than 7 points according to child Q score. Do you remember child score and criteria? Students, how is it? And child score. What include child score? What criteria? Somebody hear me? Somebody can say 5 criteria of child score. Presence of amblyopathies, encephalopathy, stage of encephalopathy, albumin, bilirubin, and prothrombin time. In this way we calculate child score. And patients with child score higher than 7 points are contraindication for interferon administration. What years, I don't know if you will remember, but doses of entecavir in case of patient with decompensated cirrhosis is higher than in case of hepatitis. In hepatitis, it's 0.5 milligrams every day. In case of cirrhosis, 1 milligram. About ACV infection. Also, as we studied before, treatment should be considered without delay in patients with significant fibrosis or cirrhosis, metavir score, 2, 3, or 4, and including decompensated cirrhosis. And direct acting antiviral drugs, based regimens, and the only option in HCV infection with decompensated cirrhosis with or without an indication for liver transplantation. And in patients after liver transplantation because of their virological efficacy, easy to use, safety, and tolerability. Do you understand? Yes? These drugs are without major or absolute contraindication, without very big or very important, significant adverse effects, and that's why we can give patient with decompensated cirrhosis. What are important, look here, please, protease inhibitors containing regimens. Ritonavir, boosted, paritaprevir, grazoprevir, okay, for you maybe not to remember, are contraindicated in patients with decompensated cirrhosis. We can use another drugs. And here are the same groups of drugs that you studied in case of chronic hepatitis C, NS3 inhibitors, NS5A, inhibitors nucleotide and non-nucleotide inhibitors NS5. Dasatovir, sofosbuvir, it's the same drugs you will study and will see. What is important for cirrhosis, especially decompensated cirrhosis? Waiting liver transplantation with NAEL score less than 18-20 can be treated with sofosbuvir and ledipasvir or sofosbuvir and velpatasvir with daily weight-based ribavirin for 12 weeks. Remember, please, in case of hepatitis, for you, is two drugs, yes, for 12 weeks. In case of compensated cirrhosis, it's the same treatment. In case of decompensated cirrhosis, treatment is longer. If we treat only with DAA, with direct antiviral drugs, sofosbuvir or ledipasvir, sofosbuvir or velpatasvir, we treat 24 weeks. Yeah? Did you understand? Understood that treatment or duration of treatment in decompensated cirrhosis is longer or can be, look here, 12 weeks in association with ribavirin. This is difference. Asha, liver transplantation is a treatment of choice for patient with end stage liver disease. In patient waiting liver transplantation, antiviral therapy is indicated because it prevents graft infection, the new liver. About autoimmune hepatitis, we will be special lecture, but autoimmune cirrhosis is treated with the corticosteroid prednisolone monotherapy or in combination with immunosuppressant drugs such as azathioprine. In case of liver or chronic hepatitis, you will discuss. Main line of treatment is prednisolone corticosteroids in association with azathioprine. And now, if you remember about immunosuppressant drugs, what is the main adverse effect of these drugs? Can lead to what adverse effects? Azathioprine. Pancytopenia, yes. One of the main important drugs side effects is leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, anemia, but patients with liver cirrhosis, especially decompensated liver cirrhosis, have this complication. That's why sometimes azathioprine is contraindicated. The dose of prednisolone is the same like in hepatitis. We start with 0.51 milligrams per kilogram body weight and reduce the dose to the maintaining dose about 10-20 milligrams every day. And azathioprine, we start with dose of 30 milligrams and after we can increase. The duration of treatment is long. Sometimes can be all the life. And also what is important for treatment of autoimmune cirrhosis is combination of calcium, sodium fluorophosphates with vitamin D is essential for patient for prophylaxis of osteoporosis or for treatment of osteoporosis. Students, just 10 minutes. Wait, please, a few minutes. I have a problem with Romanian group I want to discuss.
Dacă ați dat să se pare, domnul Harris, domnul Harris, o prăjit cu de-a noastră să știți cum va dacă nu dă de la Să-i dați domnul Gheorghe să-i răsfacă.
Ok, let's continue. Romanian group not started yet. It's a problem with presentation with the internet. A bile duct disorder. The main disease from bile duct disorder are primary biliary cholangitis and primary sclerosing cholangitis. In this case, in this disease, the important syndrome is cholestatic syndrome. Yes, with cholestasis, with itching, and that's why we give pathogenetic treatment, ursodeoxycholic acid. Please remember, 15-20 milligrams per kilogram every day for a long time also in association of with symptomatic treatment. Itching is usually controlled by cholesterol drugs such as cholestyramine or cholestipol. Cholestyramine for 24 grams per day. Also can use naloxone or naltrexone, rifampicin, an agent that inhibits hepatic bile acid uptake and may detoxify hepatic bile acids, or ultraviolet therapy also can be used. Antibiotics are recommended for infection, especially for secondary biliary cholangitis. Immunosuppressant drugs, prednisolone, azathioprine, methotrexate, may also be used, especially in treatment of autoimmune cholangitis or primary sclerosing cholangitis. And the same, I think students remember the mechanism why in case of patient with bile duct disorder, with this cholangitis, appear malabsorption of lipids and liposoluble vitamins. That's why for prophylaxis is necessary to give them fat soluble vitamins A, D, E, K, and prevention of osteopathy, osteoporosis, the same with calcium, vitamin D, with bisphosphonates, zinc deficiency, and symptomatic treatment. But main treatment is ursodeoxycholic acid in association is a present very significant itching, treatment of itching. Cirrhosis due to non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Also, we will study this lecture, and I want also to say that weight reduction through diet and physical exercise, diabetes and cholesterol management as a primary approaches to treating this disease. We don't have something approved that can improve the histological picture in case of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, but are recommended such drugs as polyglitazones or non-diabetic treatment. Metformin, vitamin E is recommended in non-alcoholic steatohepatitis in non-diabetic patient. In case of hypertriglyceridemia, can be used omega-3 fatty acids, statins, and bariatric surgery in obese patient refractory to medical measures. Hemochromatosis, also we have left hemochromatosis and Wilson disease, and you will discuss a lot, but for hemochromatosis is important phlebotomy. Do you know what is phlebotomy? Removing of the blood, and deferoxamine also. In case of Wilson disease, d-penicillamine, zinc, and copper chelating agent. Right, then. Trentin. Our next goal of treatment, and which I will discuss today, this is a treatment or management of complication of cirrhosis. And we will start with what was as important, and I will show also at the end of our lecture, is screening patient, all the patient that are with liver cirrhosis or in which you suspect liver cirrhosis need screening for varices and hepatocarcinoma. This is very important. I said on Friday that all the patients with advanced fibrosis and cirrhosis need every 6 months ultrasound or sometimes in suspicion and tomography or magnetic resonance to make the screening for detection, for early detection of hepatocarcinoma. And also, in all the patient is recommended upper endoscopy. Here you have an esophagogastroduodenoscopy or upper endoscopy should be performed once the diagnosis of cirrhosis is established. And the objective of the gastroscopy is to detect the presence size of varices for determining whether the patient should receive therapy for prevention of first varicial hemorrhage. Remember, please, primary prophylaxis, this is important. And what to use in this case? For primary prophylaxis of bleeding or for treatment of portal hypertension, we have two accepted methods of treatment. This is medical treatment, and first of all, with non-selective beta blockers and endoscopic treatment, which can be endoscopic varicial ligation or scleral therapy. More important is varicial ligation. It's more better, we'll discuss. And about non-selective beta blockers, propranolol, nadolol, anaprilin, reduced portal pressure by reducing the cardiac output, this is effect of beta 1 blockade, and more importantly is by reducing portal blood inflow, so splanchic vasoconstriction. What is important also, how we check the effect of beta blocker, we should achieve the maximal tolerated dose to heart rate. Heart rates must not be less than 55-60 beats per minute. And propranolol is recommended twice a daily, started with doses of 20 milligrams, nadolol 20-40 milligrams, and we can increase the dose. Contraindication side effects, I think you know what are the contraindication of non-beta blockers. It can be asthma, insulin-dependent diabetes, with episodes of hypoglycemia and peripheral vascular disease. But patient can have as side effects or adverse effects, dizziness, fatigue, shortness of breath. But some of this patient or some of this effect disappear with time after reduction of the dose of beta blockers. That's why patient can take this treatment. And here you have the management of varices according to sizes. In case of small varices, it's recommended non-selective beta blockers. In case of medium-large varices, it's recommended and beta blockers and endoscopic varicial ligation. And ligate every 1-2 weeks until varicial obliteration appear, and first surveillance endoscopy 1-3 months after obliteration, then after 6-12 months.
Treatment of acute variceal hemorrhage may be studied in surgical disease. It's the same. We start with general measures, volume blood be expanded to maintain the systolic blood pressure about 90/100 millimeters, and colloids are more effective than crystalloids. And what is important to remember in this case that transfusion goals are required to maintain the hemoglobin level about 80 gram per liter or 8 gram per deciliter, as total blood restitution is associated with increases in portal pressure and higher rates of rebleeding. Do you understand? If we transfuse, or if you restitute a big quantity of colloids, of fluid, of blood, we can provoke rebleeding because we increase the portal pressure. That's why it's recommended to maintain hemoglobin level about 8 gram per deciliter, not more. Also, one of the main complications associated with variceal hemorrhage is bacterial infection. That's why it's recommended antibiotic prophylaxis for this and oral norfloxacin at a dose of 400 milligrams twice daily for 7 days was recommended. In case of patient with malnutrition, ascites, encephalopathy, and hyperbilirubinemia, it's recommended intravenous.
Скажи, у тебя есть телефон из Тельяна? Можешь мне
дать? 1 грамм per day.
Я хочу с ним поговорить, как он организовал этот вебинар через министерство. У вас как пришли эти бумаги?
Do you understand? Norfloxacin or in case
of complicated
patient? Чефтреаксон.
Так вот, меня интересует, как это все. Мне тоже школу хочу организовать семинар. Алло.
Дана, доктор, гидес, микрофон, уксаудит, хочу дурбить. Transfusion of fresh frozen plasma and platelets can be considered in patients with significant coagulopathy and thrombocytopenia. The most rational approach is the control of acute variceal hemorrhage consists of the combination of pharmacological and endoscopic therapy. In general, let's start with pharmacological. For pharmacological therapy, it's recommended somatostatin or analogs of octreotide and can be initiated as soon as diagnosis of variceal hemorrhage is suspected, before diagnostic gastroscopy, upper endoscopy. These drugs act by producing splanching vasoconstriction and decreasing portal blood inflow. Octreotide is recommended at an initial bolus dose of 50 micrograms after we continue with infusion, intravenous infusion. But also, pay your attention here, look here, please, about endoscopic treatment. Regarding endoscopic therapy, endoscopic variceal ligation is more effective than endoscopic variceal sclerotherapy with greater control of hemorrhage, with less rebleeding, lower rates of adverse events, and without differences in mortality. And what is important, upper endoscopy and endoscopic variceal ligation should be performed during the diagnostic upper endoscopy if a variceal source of hemorrhage is confirmed. Yes. If you suspect hemorrhage in case of patient with cirrhosis, yes, you perform first investigation is upper endoscopy. And during this upper endoscopy, it's recommended also to perform variceal ligation if the source of hemorrhage is from varices. Do you understand? And here you can see or look at this picture about endoscopic sclerotherapy. And here is ligation, endoscopic ligation of varices. This is banded varices which can fall after 10 days after ligation. Balloon tamponade is effective only in controlling bleeding temporarily in case if we don't have upper endoscopy with ligation or sclerotherapy, but it's not for long long time. And what is also important, when we remove this balloon Blackmore, it can be rebleeding. That's why it's not very recommended, very used in case of varicose ligation. But in region, in country, in Moldova, we also use sometimes for short time balloon tamponade after we decide the treatment, ligation, sclerotherapy, or another methods. And here is this balloon with free tubes, but I think now from surgical. And we'll discuss more in seminar. If a patient or if this treatment that we discussed failed, pharmacological endoscopic treatment of bleeding, next step in treatment is TIPS, transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunts, or shunt therapy if it's available. Here you can see surgery bypass. It can be between splenic and renal, iatrosplenic renal bypass, or can be between portal vein and inferior vena cava. But what is the splenorenal shunts or ANAVI? I want to ask you, what is the adverse effect of this shunt? What can appear in this case? How do you think, students? How is it? Portosystemic shunts we discussed. It's the cause of what complication of liver cirrhosis? Hepatic encephalopathy, da, students? And in patient with high stage of hepatic encephalopathy, this TIPS is contraindicated. And also it can be the type of shunts also can lead to or can worse the hepatic encephalopathy. Asham, what else in case of prevention of recurrent varicose hemorrhage? Also, we can use nitrates, isosorbate mononitrates. About non-selective beta blockers are contraindicated in case of active bleeding because they can provoke hypotension. Yes, that's why are not used in case of bleeding, but nitrates intravenous can be used. Another complication of liver cirrhosis, this is ascites, and we'll discuss on Friday about ascites, about the spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, but I didn't show you the grading of ascites. Look here, please. Grade 1 or mild ascites is only detectable by ultrasound examination. Grade 2, moderate ascites, is manifest by moderate symmetrical distension of the abdomen. And grade 3 or large or gross ascites provokes marked abdominal distension and not respond to treatment. And how we treat ascites? Asha, we start with sodium restriction. That management of sodium balance, because sodium retention is a major factor in the development of ascites, a key goal of therapy is the attainment of a negative sodium balance. And for this reason, is recommended in general patients begin with diet containing less than 2,000 milligrams of sodium daily. Some patients with refractory big ascites can use only 500 milligrams, but this is only for short time. It's not recommended very strict sodium restriction for long time. About bed rest, often facilitates diuresis because upright position activates sodium retaining system and impairs renal perfusion and sodium excretion. Water restriction should not be prescribed if fever, sepsis, bleeding, or azotemia are present. And it is usually not necessary to restrict water intake unless the sodium in the blood or serum sodium is less than 125 microequivalents per deciliter. You have the European recommendation from guideline. It's the same. We start with moderate restriction of sodium, 80-120 millimole per day, corresponding to 4.67 grams of salt. Very low sodium diet should be avoided. And also prolonged bed rest cannot be recommended. Next step in treatment, if the patient not respond to sodium restriction, the next in treatment is administration of diuretics. And we start with anti-mineralocorticoid drugs alone from 100 milligrams per day with 100 milligrams stepwise increased every 3 days, every 7 to 2 hours, because effect of anti-mineralocorticoid drug appear after 3 days. We should wait 3 days to see response patient increase, diuresis is increased or not. If not responded, in this case, we can increase spironolactone or the next step is furosemide. In patient who not respond to anti-mineralocorticoid or who developed hyperkalemia, furosemide should be added. We start with 40 milligrams per day, with 40 milligrams stepwise increases to a maximum dose of 160 milligrams per day of furosemide. And long staging or recurrent ascites need combination of anti-mineralocorticoid drug and furosemide. Instead of furosemide, you can use torosemide also, especially in patients with non-responding with big ascites. About this we discuss. Spironolactone alone of furosemide. And diuretic therapy in general is generally not recommended in patients with persistent hepatic encephalopathy. We'll discuss. How we check if the patient responds to diuretic treatment? Recommended maximum weight loss 0.5 kilograms per day in patients without edema, and to lose 1 kilogram per day in patient with edema. Do you understand? Is recommended to see the weight loss. And is recommended in patient without edema, only aside 0.5 kilograms per day in patient with edema, and ascites 1 kilogram per day. Once ascites have largely resolved, the dose of diuretics should be reduced to the lowest effective dose. And what is important is necessary to discontinue furosemide in case of severe hypokalemia. Do you remember from pharmacology that furosemide can provoke hypokalemia? Mineral, anti-mineralocorticoids drugs, hyperkalemia, and spironolactone also should be discontinued in case of hyperkalemia, higher than 6 millimole per liter. And also in treatment is important albumin infusion or baclofen administration in patients with muscle cramps. Next step in treatment of ascites, if the patient not respond to medical treatment, sodium restriction, we consider it large volume paracentesis. Contraindication for large volume paracentesis include uncooperative patient, abdominal skin infection, pregnancy, severe coagulopathy, as we discussed on Friday about laparoscopy, but it's contraindicated in decompensated cirrhosis because patients are with decreased clotting factors, with the thrombocytopenia, and the same in large volume paracentesis and severe bowel distension. Large volume paracentesis should be followed by plasma volume expansion. And plasma volume expansion should be performed by albumin infusion, 8 grams per liter of ascites. When we remove less than 5 liters of ascites, we can use an colloid or another. It's not absolutely necessary albumin, but when we remove less than 5, do you understand? But when we remove more than 5 liters of ascites, it's recommended albumin infusion. And after large volume paracentesis, patients should receive the minimum dose of diuretics to prevent the accumulation of fluid. Asha, about weight loss we discuss. And what another complication of diuretic therapy can be renal failure, hepatic encephalopathy, electrolyte disorder, gynecomastia. I think you know that can appear in patient. Gynecomastia is present in patient with liver cirrhosis, but can be the adverse effect of spironolactone. Muscle cramps, especially for furosemide, and we discuss in case of muscle cramps, is recommended albumin infusion. In case of electrolyte disorder, depends. If it's hypokalemia, it's recommended kalium to transfusion with kalium. Hepatic encephalopathy, a little late. We discuss about. And all diuretics should be discontinued in case of severe hyponatremia, progressive renal failure, worsening hepatic encephalopathy, and severe muscle cramps. Confusion of albumin. Here you can see the patient with paracentesis, with catheter, and during the few hours, it depends on volume of fluid, how many liters we remove patient. So here is patient with paracentesis, with large volume paracentesis, therapeutic paracentesis, because on Friday we discussed about diagnostic paracentesis. Also, we can use the alpha pump system. It's a pump that can be put on the patient, and patient can this device draws fluid from the abdominal cavity into the bladder, or is eliminated through normal urination. It's not very used, this system, but for you to know that exist, alpha pump system. And the removal of large volume paracentesis, large volume of ascitic fluid, sometimes is associated with circulatory dysfunction, known as post-paracentesis circulatory dysfunction. And for this, to prevent this dysfunction, is recommended administration of albumin. Next step in treatment of ascites is transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunts. It's effective in the management of refractory ascites, but it's associated with high risk of hepatic encephalopathy, as I said. A tips placement produces a decrease in sinusoidal pressure and in plasma renin and aldosterone levels, with subsequent improved urinary sodium excretion. And but sometimes enough to tip, patient required continual administration of diuretics and salt restriction. And the transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunting is contraindicated in patients with severe liver failure, with high bilirubin, increased INR, in patients with hepatic encephalopathy grade 2 or higher, with active infection, progressive renal failure, and severe cardiopulmonary disease. And that's why it's not very used, not very common, this type of treatment. But you know, you should know about. And the last methods in treatment, if the patient not responds to another methods, is liver transplantation. Should be considered as a potential means of treatment. Here it's an algorithm that we discussed just now about alcohol cessation, avoid the hepatotoxic drugs, sodium restriction, diuretics, start to use spironolactone after furosemide, large volume paracentesis, shunting or portosystemic, transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunt, and the last one, liver transplantation. I think we'll make a few minutes break, students, after we continue with treatment of another complication. Do you hear me? Because I want to send for you by chat the link for the question. You have one question to respond because it's our request of our department. That's why I will send for you this link, and please quickly answer the question. Sammy, please, if you can open and can respond to.
No, we need some kind of permission.
What is not possible to open?
No, we need permission to enter.
Okay, I just now I'll see why. I'll try. It's open. Why? I know what. I know what you need. Just a minute. Just a minute. I should something to put in this to be to access for walls for everybody. Just a minute. I'll check. check now, please, once again. This link.
Yeah, it opened.
Just I think now I think you can open. Okay, let's continue, students. But why you have only 18 answer to question? Why not all the students respond? Because Dr. Angela makes the presence at the lecture after your response. Okay, for us it's important. How correct you respond, it's important to if you understand or not, but also this is for your presence at the lecture. Majority of you respond correct, have respond correct.
Doctor, the link doesn't work. The link?
You have here in chat, link.
But it doesn't open, why?
What? It's open. Your Yanagi colleagues could.
Can you send it again? Because
it's work. It's work. It's open. Try again. Okay. Do you hear me? And you can see the presentation, students.
Yes.
Yes. We continue about with treatment of liver cirrhosis. Daunde eram noi? Here, I think bacterial infection. About next complication of liver cirrhosis, spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, and about the signs and diagnosis we discussed on Friday. Now I think we'll continue with treatment. And empirical intravenous antibiotics should be started immediately following diagnosis. Several factors should guide empirical antibiotics use: environment, local bacterial resistance profiles, and severity of infection. And third generation cephalosporins such cefotaxime and ceftazidime given at the dosage of 2 grams per day are recommended at first-line antibiotic treatment for community acute spontaneous bacterial peritonitis in countries with low rates of antibiotic resistance. Students, I can't accept Dr. Angela only can. I can't. But I think she's not here. She's not. You are late, but I can't accept you. I read the message, but I can't accept. And in country with high rates of antibiotics resistance, piperacillin and azobactam of carbapenem should be considered. And antibiotic resistance is more likely in healthcare associated or nosocomial spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. And in this case, it's recommended piperacillin, tazobactam, carbapenem, or carbapenem plus glycopeptides, daptomycin, linezolid in areas with high prevalence of gram-positive bacteria. But for you to remember that the first line of treatment is third-generation cephalosporin, cefotaxime and ceftazidime, intravenous 2 grams per day. In case of resistance, in country with high resistance to antibiotics, can be used carbapenem or piperacillin tazobactam. What else? Antibiotic efficacy should be checked with a second paracentesis after 48 hours from starting treatment. Suspect failure of first-line antibiotics if worsening clinical signs and symptoms and or increase or no marked reduction in leukocyte count. Do you remember about leukocytes and polymorphonuclear diagnosis, more than 250 characteristic for diagnosis of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis? That's why after 48 hours after starting treatment with antibiotics, we repeat paracentesis with investigation of fluid. And also about albumin. Administration of albumin is recommended in patients with spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, 1.5 gram per kilogram in first day or at diagnosis, and 1 gram per kilogram on third day, on day three. And the patient with cirrhosis and low acidic fluid protein concentration and high serum bilirubin level are at the high risk of development of first episode of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. And we, for this reason, for prophylaxis, we use norfloxacin, if you remember, in case of bleeding also, norfloxacin 400 milligrams per day. And the norfloxacin prophylaxis should be stopped in patients with long-lasting improvement of their clinical condition. About albumin we discussed, it's recommended to, I repeat, to add to antibiotic treatment albumin perfusion. This improves the state of patient, this decreases the days of hospitalization, this decreases mortality. That's why it's better to give the association of antibiotics and albumin. About hepatorenal syndrome or renal dysfunction in case of liver disease. Look here, because the liver is complicated. Initial acute kidney injury, stage one. We recommend, or not we, but recommendation from guidelines are close monitoring, remove the risk factors, withdrawal of nephrotoxic drugs, vasodilator, non-steroids, anti-inflammatory drugs, decrease the diuretics or stop treatment with diuretics and beta blockers. It's recommended plasma expanded volume and treat infection when it's diagnosed. If we receive resolution, is recommended close follow-up. If it's persistence, we decide the next step in red, we discuss, and if it's progression also. If this acute kidney injury not respond to this recommendation, this indication that we made, we should stop all the diuretics and volume expansion with albumin, 1 gram per kilogram for 4 days. If respond to treatment, we treat symptomatic cirrhosis. If not, is specific treatment for hepatorenal syndromes with vasoconstrictors and albumin. I will show you treatment with terlipressin, vasoconstrictors, just now. Yeah, first line therapy is terlipressin plus albumin. Terlipressin can be given by intravenous bolus 1 milligram every 4-6 hours and by continue with intravenous perfusion. In case of non-response, a decrease in serum creatinine after 2 days, the dose of terlipressin should be increased. and maximum to 12 milligrams. Okay, maybe it's very complicated for you to remember. Treatment of hepatorenal syndrome is terlipressin or vasoconstricted drugs plus albumin. Also, we can use noradrenaline as alternative to terlipressin or midodrine plus octreotide. We also use octreotide in case of hepatorenal syndrome, octreotide plus albumin. So what else I want to show you here in treatment? And the most patient with hepatorenal syndrome, acute kidney injury tips is contraindicated because of severe degree of liver failure. And therapeutic option for this patient is liver transplantation. If you remember from Friday, I said that the hepatorenal syndrome is a progressive syndrome with very bad prognosis. Lastly, patient need liver transplantation because they progress to decompensate liver disease and hepatorenal or renal insufficiency. Ce mai avem aici? Albumin, norfloxacin for prophylaxis of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis also. About use of beta blockers. No data on whether it is better to stop or continue beta blockers in patients with hepatorenal syndrome. But in general, it's recommended to stop because they decrease the pressure, but we discuss production in the pathogenesis of hepatorenal syndrome, we have hypoperfusion in the kidney. Yes, that's why we give vasoconstricted drugs and beta blockers in the compensated liver cirrhosis in renal insufficiency is contraindicated. It's, we should stop. And paracinesis, but paracinesis and the diuretic also. You remember that I said all the diuretics are stopped, will draw in patient with hepatorenal syndromes. But large volume paracinesis with albumin is recommended for treatment because this improves the state of patient. Yeah, all diuretics should be stopped, I said. Spironolactone is contraindicated because of high risk of life threatening hyperkalemia, da, and arrhythmia and cardiac stop, and terlipressin, yes, we said, but what about terlipressin? Contraindication for terlipressin therapy include ischemic cardiovascular disease. That's why a patient must be screened before treatment for cardiac arrhythmia, for ischemia. Terlipressin significantly increases mean arterial pressure and systemic vascular resistance, while the heart rate, cardiac output, hepatovenous port gradient that we discuss, and portal venous blood flow decrease significantly. And this is the effect of terlipressin in case of hepatorenal syndrome. And the improvement and hemodynamics is associated with increasing glomerular filtration rate, deactivation of vasoconstrictor and sodium conserving hormones, and reduced activity of the renin-angiotensin system and increased natriuresis. Another complication of liver cirrhosis is portosystemic encephalopathy. Yes, if you remember, hepatic encephalopathy. And first of all, in management of hepatic encephalopathy is recommended to remove all the triggering factors. I don't remember if we discussed on Friday about triggering factors. Yes, but will lead to worsening of hepatic encephalopathy. And what are these trigger factors? It can be incorrect food intake. Yes, hyperproteinemia with high level of animal proteins. да, also incorrect treatment with diuretics, yeah, hypokalemia, a lot of drugs, what kind of drugs may force the encephalopathy? Benzodiazepines, да, antidepressive drugs, and that's why these drugs are contraindicated in patients with liver cirrhosis and encephalopathy. Bleeding, gastrointestinal bleeding, bleeding from varices, and we need initial treatment includes identifying and treating of all the precipitating factors or trigger factors. About nutrition, attention to nutrition. Rigid protein restriction is not recommended. Protein restriction 40-60 grams, not appropriate long term. Да? In general, is recommended normal protein intake 68 grams per day. And patient need at least 25-35 kilocalories per kilograms, but more than 200 of carbohydrate to spike protein metabolism. Do you understand? And proteins must be vegetable, not animal proteins. And vegetable-based diet increases elimination of nitrogen production in the stool. What in treatment? Initial treatment start with non-absorbable disaccharides, lactulose. All of you know about this. Lactulose, 50-40 milliliters 4 times daily. What is the effect? Avocado. What is the effect of lactulose or non-absorbable disaccharides? Decreases fecal pH by inhibiting production of ammonia by fecal flora. Also increases fecal ammonia excretion. And lactose is effective in lactase deficient patients. Lactulose, a synthetic non-absorbable disaccharide, is not metabolized by intestinal disaccharides, and therefore reaches the colon where it is broken down by the fecal flora. The breakdown of lactulose to short-chain fatty acids result in decreased fecal pH that inhibits ammonia production by urea, splitting microorganisms, and traps fecal ammonia. And also another effect of lactulose, you will discuss also an intestinal disease, is, as you know, non-absorbable disaccharides are used in treatment of constipation. Yes, lactulose increase movement of large intestine of gut. In this way, also increase the elimination of these toxic products and of ammonia also. That's why lactulose is recommended in treatment of hepatic encephalopathy. And the dose of lactulose needs to be given or impatient to receive the 2 or 3 loose bowel movement per day, 2-3 stools per day, for your understanding. Patient needs to have 2-3 stools per day. In this case, dose of lactulose is good. Așa, ce am mai vrut aici spune? Another line in treatment of portosystemic encephalopathy is antibiotics, and first antibiotic recommended in this case was neomycin, but neomycin is with potential nephrotoxicity, and we discussed that in case of liver disease, we should avoid all the drugs with nephrotoxicity, hepatotoxicity, And that's why we recommended metronidazole, 25 milligrams twice daily, also non-absorbable antibiotics. But more better now is recommended rifaximin. Please remember, because you have in your books, in your test in Israel, about in general the main or most important line of treatment in case of hepatic encephalopathy are non-absorbable antibiotics, the lactulose, disaccharides, lactulose, and non-absorbable antibiotics, rifaximin, 200 milligrams 3 times daily. They work by decreasing the colon concentration of ammoniogenic bacteria with resulting improvement in the symptoms of hepatic encephalopathy. What else we can use? Zinc administration, usually the administration of zinc is also indicated in case of hepatic encephalopathy, and additional administration of ornithine aspartate. Aspartate, ornithine, I don't have here, but okay for next time. But if you remember, maybe urea cycle in the liver, students, I mean, this is labiochemia. In case of urea cycle, when ammonia is metabolized to urea and eliminated, need different kind of amino acids. And ornithine, aspartate are these amino acids that are involved in metabolism of urea in the liver and elimination of ammonia. That's why it's recommended. Branch chain amino acids also are recommended. Branch chain amino acid and ornithine and aspartate and another amino acids. Awesome. And treatment of hepatic fibrosis, because we discuss about that fibrosis is the main important mechanism and development of cirrhosis. But unfortunately, at the moment, we don't have something approved that can decrease or regress the fibrosis in the liver in case of liver cirrhosis. What is recommended is to eliminate the cause of injury, and we'll discuss it's important to remove the etiological factors and etiological treatment, antiviral, immunosuppressant drugs in case of autoimmune, also deoxycholic in cholestatic disease, and so on. Reduce inflammation and the immune response with different. Because if you remember, we discussed in pathogenesis about pro-inflammatory cytokines, yes, students? And that's why I use for this reason anti-TNF-alpha drugs as pentoxifilin, antioxidant of hepatoprotection, that this can be silymarin, and it's recommended as antifibrotic drugs in case of liver cirrhosis. Anti-interleukin 13, also anti-pro-inflammatory cytokines. And target-specific signaling, receptor-ligand interaction or intracellular signaling. About antagonist of cannabinoid receptor or 5-HT2B receptor or angiotensin receptor blocker, losartan. All of you know about sartans, yes? Angiotensin receptor blockers. And I not said, it's not written here, but you have in your book about treatment of portal hypertension and patient, do you remember prophylaxis for hemorrhage we discussed at the beginning? How we treat? You read it correct, you said correct that it's non-selective beta blockers, and ligation. But in patient with contraindication to non-selective beta blockers, we can use angiotensin receptor blocker or sartans. are with both effects, anti-fibrotic effect and decreased support of hypertension. Did you understand what I said about sartans, angiotensin receptor blockers? Can be used in case of liver cirrhosis. Yes, anti-fibrotic drug and decreased support of hypertension. And also reduce fibrogenesis, inhibit matrix synthesis. Yeah, we discuss in pathogenesis about metalloproteinases, yeah, inhibitors of metalloproteinases, or something that now in the course of investigation, increasing scar matrix degradation, alkylizeal oxidase to stimulated apoptosis of stellate cells or bone marrow or cell transplantation. Here you have one scheme about pathogenesis and how we can react or intervene or different parts of treatment at the different mechanism of fibrosis. But as I said, we don't something approved. All these drugs are in course of investigation. Unfortunately, yes. Because if we can use something anti-fibrotic, some drugs to regress fibrosis, we'll be very. And about symptomatic treatment, fat-soluble vitamins in case of deficiency, about vitamin K, because we discuss about prothrombin time decrease, coagulation factors are decreased in a patient with liver disease. It's recommended administration of vitamin K, fat-soluble vitamins in case of cholestatic disease, because patients are with malabsorption of lipids and these vitamins. Silymarin is hepatoprotective and antifibrotic drug. What else? Colchicine. Inhibition of progressive fibrosis in cirrhotic patient. However, this was not confirmed in the latest study, that's why I not recommend it now as antifibrotic drug. And liver transplantation, it's a last method of treatment for all the causes of liver cirrhosis. Here you have the indication for liver transplantation and contraindication done. You will see and can be transplantation for living donor or from living donor transplantation. And I think we'll finish today our lecture, but also I will give you a link for another question quickly. Also, is one question and very easy question. Try, please, if you want to open.
It opens, yes.
Yes, you have. You can?
Yes.
Please, try all the students to respond. Question is not important how you respond because you're not put mark. It's important, I said, for your presence. Dr. Angela, make the presence after this questions. Try all the student to get the answer.
Another link?
Yes, it's another link for another questions. If you have some questions about treatment of liver cirrhosis, any questions, students? We'll discuss in seminar, no, maybe more.
Doctor, how successful is this treatment?
What?
the treatment liver cirrhosis. Like in the end, they will need transplant, yes?
Like what?
I say, how long he can... with the treatment, how long he can go on?
Treatment, how long is?
No, the patient, how much he can receive the treatment? Like for how long?
How long it depends
until
on
he need the transplant.
It depends of a lot of factors. First of all, I said it on Friday about this prognostic score, how we calculate after prognostic score how many years. If it's a MELD score less than 14, it's not decompensated cirrhosis, patient can live a long time, but it depends if we remove or new etiological factor. If it's viral hepatitis, it's important to treat with antiviral. It's alcoholic, to remove alcohol consumption. It depends of a lot of factors. But in case of decompensated cirrhosis, child C, or a very high level of level of MELD score, mortality rate of mortality is very high. It's 6 months and less. But it depends of stage of disease and different factors like complication, hemorrhage, ascites, or treatment of etiological factors. But sometimes with decompensated cirrhosis, child C or MELD score less than 12, patient can live a long time. But treatment for portal hypertension, beta blockers, spironolactone, it uses for a long time. Did you understand? It's indefinitely for all the, if the viruses are present, we should to perform the treatment for prophylaxis of bleeding. If it's for hepatitis B, if you remember, cirrhosis due to HPV infection, also is indefinitely. It depends of factors. On the seminar, I will show you once again about child score and MELD score and what is the rate of mortality, independence of this score.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.
Yes, thank you for your attention, and the same. Have a nice day.
Thank you too, doctor. Bye-bye.
Bye.
What time the lesson, doctor, tomorrow?
What you ask? What time? What? I not understand about what time you use.
Tomorrow the same at 12 o'clock?
Tomorrow is the same. Seminar, you have your doctors, if your teachers, I don't know, it is 9 at 8 and 30, and lecture will be at 12. Try to be before 12 or 12 and 5 and 10 minutes, because after, I think Dr. Angela is not here, not accept another students. I can't accept.
Okay, doctor, thank you.
Our lesson, doctor, at 9.
Thank you. Bye.